Ladies and gentlemen, welcome on this very beautiful night to the 39th edition of Odorama on Bitter, the Bitter Essence. And we have a great lineup of people for you today. Great speakers, Kees Wabeke, a gardener, Bas Visser, beer sommelier, Sarojini Lewis, artist and scholar, and Sabine Poutsma, art historian and chocolatier. And my name is Caro Verbeek, and I'm an art and scent historian. And we founded Odorama already 5 years ago, and we follow this motto by Umberto Eco. So scents should be turned into stimuli for critical reflection. This means that we don't just talk about smell, we don't just look at pictures of other people smelling, we actually smell and taste things ourselves. Because I think it's fundamental if you want to understand smell and taste culture better. Just a little poll to start this night. Who of you says, okay, which of these bitter products is your favorite? Who would say coffee? Quite some people say coffee. Who would say beer? I cannot live without beer, some people over there. Chocolate. Yes, also some chocolate fans. Brussels sprouts? No one. Brussels sprouts over here. And sopropo. Who would say sopropo? Or Karela? One person over here. It's not very well known. Luckily, Sarojini will tell us much more about sopropo during this night. And another thing, who associates Brussels sprouts to bitterness? Okay, so a few people do not. That means that you probably were born in 1990 or even after 1990, because Brussels sprouts used to be very bitter. Yeah, it's really a big loss. There is a revival of bitter, though, and it's becoming more and more popular. So the largest difference in popularity for taste between 2008 and 2018 is found in bitter, according to a trend watcher. Why is this? Because people realize that sweetness is not healthy and that bitterness actually is. So there's more appreciation for healthy and pure products. These are the five tastes, and each taste is actually an indication of a certain building block. So sweetness, carbohydrates and proteins, sour, vitamins, salty, minerals, umami, proteins, and bitter, toxins. And there's something incredibly special going on with bitterness, because we only have one receptor for sweet, one for sour, one for salty and umami, but over 30 for bitter. This means that apparently for humankind, it's incredibly important to recognize bitter. Why are bitter products so healthy? They can evoke an immune response, help our digestive system, they're anti-inflammatory, and there's even a Dutch saying, bitter in de mond maakt het hart gezond, so it's really good for your heart. Now, children do not like bitterness. Bitter is actually the only acquired taste. You have to learn to like it. And when small children taste something bitter for the first time, they pull the certain bitter face. And I wanted to see this for myself. Okay, I have a kid. I thought, okay, is this too mean? Yeah, it is kind of mean, but I'll do it anyway. So here you'll see my son tasting bitterness for the very first time. But he learned quite well, so he got accustomed to bitterness a few minutes later.
Mm-hmm.
nog wat? So, you see how at first he is not very willing, but he keeps wanting more. He's slowly getting adjusted. My favorite biologist, Midas Dekkers, also has something to say about bitterness and why it is an acquired taste. It's a bit long, but he's such a lovely author. So, beginning of quote, "No matter how bitter Belgian endive may taste, we eat them anyway. It's a question of upbringing and getting older. Children are simply too young for endive and Brussels sprouts. Their intestines aren't up for it and their tongues can't stand it, and rightly so. A good glass of cognac and a lovely cigar are also beyond a toddler's ability to appreciate. Even beer is enough to make a healthy child gag. At the insistence of parents and bad friends, people learn to ignore warning signals of their noses and tongues. But there are also tastes that even children are cured of. A newborn baby doesn't see anything wrong with poo. It'll grope around in its nappy, searching for nice sweet tidbits. All of us have grown up big and strong with a bit of poo in our diet. It takes years of upbringing to keep a child away from the snacks produced by his own body. Learning to turn up your nose at shit is just as acquired as learning to like endive. The Story of Shit, it's a great book. It's really beautiful. So you see that even though we are repulsed by shit, we enjoy bitterness, but it's the same process of learning. It's cultural, not biological. And now something very important. What actually is the difference between tasting and smelling? A lot of people know that they are intertwined, but what is the exact difference of tasting and smelling? You all have a package underneath your seats that you can get right now. And in that package, you'll find a jelly bean. And I'll demonstrate what you'll do with that jelly bean. Don't do it yet, but I'll explain to you what you'll do. First, you'll take a deep breath. Then you close your nose. Only then, while keeping your nose closed, you put it in your mouth. And then you bite a bit and suck a bit and try to perceive what you experience. Then, at my sign, I ask you to let go of your nose again, and then you'll see what happens, okay? So I'll count to three. One, two, three, inhale. Close your nose, insert jelly bean, and chew and taste. You're supposed to keep your nose closed. And if you're getting short, if you're getting out of breath, please breathe, but through your mouth. Okay, one, two, three, let go. Exhale. So, I want to ask some members of the audience what just happened. Who can explain what just happened?
From no taste to taste. I actually, in the beginning, it was just a bit sweet and nothing, and then when I let go of my nose, the whole citrus happened.
Yeah, that's a fairly good explanation. So from no taste to taste, what actually happened is, first you just tasted it with your tongue, which is sweet, maybe a bit bitter, because this is a grapefruit jelly bean. And then once you let go of your nose, an airflow from your mouth cavity enters your nasal cavity, and that's when you actually smell internally, which is called retronasal perception. So there are only 5 tastes, and there are trillions of smells. So when you put something in your mouth, your nose is doing most of the work. So wine tasting doesn't make sense, because you only taste 5 things. Wine smelling, internally and externally. So we have 2 noses. Please remember that. And then on to the next very exciting part of this night. What is the most bitter substance in the universe. Gentian root. Has anyone of you ever experienced this substance? This is the molecule. Well, doesn't really inform us. So you can actually also taste this substance. For the people at home, here is your flavor package. The jelly bean is on top. I hope you already noticed that. So what you do is you cut open this flavor package on both sides, and then you take out number two. And for the people in the audience, grab the box beneath your seats and take blotter number two. On this blotter, you'll find an artificial equivalent of the most bitter substance in the world. It's called Bitrex. You cannot smell it, but you can taste it by putting the blotter in your mouth. Beware, it's very, very bitter, so maybe first only gently, and if you really like it, just suck the sucker. Now, who actually enjoyed this? Did people enjoy it? Yeah, you enjoyed it. And who says, oh, this is absolutely horrific? It's the most, yeah, over there. This is not just about acquiredness. This is also about genes. Some people are simply physically more sensitive to bitterness. So although all bitterness is acquired, our liking of bitterness is always acquired, but to some people it's just much more bitter than to others. And then finally, can we smell bitter? So we already noticed, okay, we can smell with our mouths. Can our nose also do what our mouths are doing? And for this, I selected a special scent. Maybe you can guess by looking at this picture which scent I chose, because here we see the adoration of the Magi, the adoration of the kings. And these kings had fragrant gifts: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. You know frankincense, it's fairly sweet. But there was also myrrh, and you probably never smelled it before. I must say, before you smell it, there's a very specific meaning to myrrh, because its bitter quality was supposed to function as a prophecy. It was prophetic, because it indicated the future suffering of Christ. Now, please have a go. Please smell your myrrh, which is number three in the package. What do you think? Can we smell bitterness? Can someone describe this smell? Okay, maybe I'll ask you to raise hands. Who smells bitterness? Two, three, four? Yeah. Who says no? I don't smell bitterness at all. Yeah. Probably when we smell something, when we think we smell a taste, like sweetness, sourness, or bitterness, it's by association. There are no taste receptors in our nose. So we smell with our mouths, but we do not taste with our noses. So we see bitter is actually really positive. It's often used as a very negative metaphor. And I hope that after this night, bitter may become a positive metaphor. Thank you.
Alrighty. So hello everyone. I'm Bas Visser. I'm the sommelier at Brewery Oedipus. I'm here to talk today about bitter and bitters in beer. I was invited by Caro to talk about the bitter essence. And I actually became a sommelier at Oedipus, beer sommelier, because what I really like is to taste flavors in the broadest way possible. So, but first I want to talk a little bit about Oedipus before I talk about what ingredients make beer bitter. This is a bit our story. So Oedipus was founded by four friends, Paul, Rick, Sander and Alex, a bit more than 8 years ago. And in that time, they were mainly home brewing. And that was all in the small, very small living room of Sander near the Haarlemmerstraat. And they were immediately super fanatic. In the first year, they already made about 100 beers, which is a crazy amount. If you ever brewed at home, you realize it even more. I did it once and I found it actually super frustrating to brew it at home. It takes so much time. But they did 100 in the first year, and I think it really makes clear that they had a mission from the start. And Sander, whose living room it was, still the main brewer. So if you look on this picture on the left side, you see him picking hops in a later stage. After this year, we just simply had too much beer to be drinking ourselves or by friends. So it was the moment to step outside of this living room and go brewing on a bigger scale. So we did. So we started to brew beers on a bigger scale, and actually we did it for two main reasons. The first reason was that we wanted to brew beers that got rid of this masculine stereotype that beer was this typical man drink. You had, in the Netherlands, you had slogans like the man and his beer and men know why, all these beer slogans. We really wanted to get rid of this. We just wanted to make colorful beers for colorful people. And discover what flavors we could make to reach that goal. And another reason why we wanted to brew beers is because we wanted to change the beer landscape in flavor as well. I think that's also where bitter comes into play, because there were two flavors that were really underrepresented. It was sour and bitter. And I think these are still flavors that really determine the Oedipus flavor signature quite a bit. We still brew our beers in Amsterdam North. So here you see our tap room. So this is also where we have a horeca, where you can drink our beers, but it's also where we make almost all of our beers. We also have some food there, not by ourselves in this place, but by the Beef Chief, the super good burgers. And this is really the beating heart of our brewery. And this is where we are now, but we really have a dream to expand, and not only in growth, but also in projects. And that's what you see here. So this is the future of Oedipus, the Oedipus Galaxy, the Big Bang is in the middle. And you see all the beers that are coming out of it. And you see also food and beer. So we really want to incorporate food more in our galaxy. But you also see the brew club. So we really want to incorporate music more, because music has been a part of Oedipus all the time. We also did music in our tap room, but sadly we couldn't continue with that because neighbors started complaining. So we want to look for a place where we can really do it on a bigger scale. And on the bottom, you also see the Oedipus Farm. And the Oedipus Farm is, I think, a bit of the pinnacle of our dreams. It's really where we want to bring back beer back to where it's coming from, because beer is quite an agricultural product. So we also would like to have a farm in the vicinity of Amsterdam where we would brew beer. So this is Oedipus very quickly, and our dreams. And these are our beers. One back. So these are the beers that we have year round, and almost all beers. That's what I said. There's some bitterness or some sourness, I think, really finds our flavor. And if you would like to try a bitter beer that fits this talk, then I would go for perhaps a Gaia or an Avatar, because it's quite nice and hoppy and crisp and bitter. All right, let's go to the bitter ingredients in beer. So these are the two main bitter ingredients of beer, the malts that we use and the hops. The other two ingredients in beer are yeast and water. And although yeast can bring some bitters, it plays a very small role. Water also has a small influence, but also plays a very small role. And of course, you can add extra ingredients in beer, but I won't discuss them now. So malts or grain. So grain is really the basis of every beer. In the Netherlands, I think it's you need to use about 60 or 70% of barley before you're allowed to call it a beer. And barley is therefore, of course, the main, the most used malt that there is, with wheat on the second place, and then you have a lot of smaller varieties like oats, rye, that are mainly used to give a thicker mouthfeel, but not as the main product you will deal with. Malts are actually the product of a process where you have a grain and that's coming from the land, and if you let it grow very slowly in a controlled environment, you actually starts to grow a plant, and you call it malting. When you get the plant, that's when you stop the process, because then in the grain you have a lot more enzymes that you use in the brewing process, and that you need to convert the starch that's in there into fermentable sugars and later in the brewing process. And if you dry these grains after the malting process, you can do it at several temperatures. If you do it at a low temperature, you get this really pale malt that you see on the left side of the picture in this slide. And you don't get a lot of bitters. You have some of you have a bit of a sweetness more even. But the more you roast them intensely, you get a darker color, and you get really clear flavors of chocolate, coffee, a bit of these roasted, burnt flavors. And as you know, these are bitter. It's not the most encountered bitter in beer. I think the most encountered bitter in beer is from the hops. So the hops, we have this sample. The nice sample number 4 fits this slide. So we're going to talk about hops, and you'll find some nice Amarillo hop in there. Bit ironically is that Amarillo is not a bitter hop. It's still bitter, but it's mostly used for its aroma, less for its bitter properties. So because in hop you have two different types of hops, you have bitter hops and you have aroma hops. And the bitter hops, they are full of alpha acids, and these alpha acids, they if you cook them, they you get an isomer of them, so they change a little bit their structure, and they give a super bitter flavor, and that's what they are used for a lot. And you have aroma hops, and aroma hops contain a lot of essential oils and less of these alpha acids. And these essential oils, they are super aromatic, and they can be, the range of aromas that are coming from this are super big, but they're also very vulnerable for aging, because these aromas, they evaporate very quick. They also age very quick under the influence of light and heat. And you have dual purpose hops that have both a lot of alpha acids and they have a lot of these essential oils. And the funny thing is that in, for example, the IPA, the most famous bitter beer that you can that you find these days, I think, it was originally made to with a lot of hop because hop conserves the beer while it was transported from the UK to India, and the hop still has this conserving, yeah, it still conserves the beer nowadays. But nowadays we use much more of this aroma hops, and they're actually super vulnerable for aging. So maybe they're, you don't get sick of them, but the flavor really decays super quickly. So nowadays IPAs are actually drunk, yeah, preferably drink them as fresh as possible because you have this super fresh hop aroma coming from these essential oils, which will decay after already a month, actually. Then there's, of course, you have these bitter and aroma hops, but there's also another difference that you often find in hops, and that's where they are growing. So the European hops that were used a lot, of course, in European beers, they have, you often find notes of herbs, grass, hay, unripe foods, for example, green banana. And it's super fresh and crisp, often used for pilsners, of course. And then you have the other hops that you find mostly in the US, they are and other hot climates like New Zealand. You often find notes of tropical fruits, but also mango, pineapple, but also a lot of times you find a bit of a resinous character. So the resin that is coming from a tree or a pine tree is kind of forest aromas in these kind of hops coming from these countries, and well, it's amazing what you get from them. And if you want to extract most of these hop aromas, you often don't boil them, but you add them at the end of the brewing process. So as I said, the bitter hop you actually add during the cooking process because the heat makes sure that these alpha acids create the bitters in the beer. But these aroma hops are more used at the end of the brewing process, so the beer is actually almost done. And then you add them pure to get these essential oils in the beer and to get this beautiful aroma to your beer. Bitters versus the rest. So bitters versus other flavors I was talking about here. In Beerland, they often use the term international bitter units, and it's calculated by the amount of alpha acids used to make the beer. And so the alpha acids were responsible for the bitters in the beer. So in that way, the international bitter units represent the bitterness of the beer, and it's often used as a marketing tool as well. People then really like bitter beers, so they want the highest IBU, but it's partly true because, of course, you can have a lot of bitters in beers, but if you don't mention the other ingredients, you don't know how it's actually going to taste because of these flavor interactions that are written down here. Sugar masks bitter, so you can use a lot of hops. If you also use a lot of sugar, you might cancel it out. Salt as well, it also masks bitter. Another thing that happens a lot is spiciness enhanced bitter. It's not often happening within a beer, but it's used in beer pairing. And the other things as well, actually. So if you know that sugar masks bitter, you can also use it in food pairing. And I wrote down the word balance because it's all about the balance of all these ingredients together. If a bitter doesn't overrule the rest, that for me makes a good beer. If there's a reasonable amount of bitter that's balanced out by the other flavor components in the beer. So talking about food pairing a little bit, because often when I'm talking to people, they talk about, yeah, food pairing is nice, and but bitters are so difficult to pair. And I find that not true, but of course also because I'm working with it a lot. But first example that you see here on the top left corner, the Gaia, so an IPA with the creme brulee, is a super good example of a wonderful combination where you have this creaminess and sweetness that really mask the bitters. But on the other hand, the bitters make the quite intense creme brulee a bit more, yeah, a bit more subtle actually by giving some freshness and some crispiness to balance out the creaminess. And also, it's not about bitters, but also the CO2 bubbles help here as well. So really try this combination if you ever are making a creme brulee at home. Then the other pairing that I'm writing down here is the Thai red curry with again with Gaia. So the Thai red curry, of course, should be a little bit spicy, and you don't want to over go too far with this. But it's really nice to enhance its spiciness a little bit with bitter notes as well, and hops help here again. Beside that, this IPA also has some fruitiness, so there's some peach notes, but also a bit of these piney notes, and they also go really well with the fruity notes of this red curry, which might be a bit sweet as well. And then I chose another beer pairing. It's not an IPA, but it's a stout. Not the most popular drink in the Netherlands, but not for the best reasons, because it's often when people try it, they do like it even more with food. So a famous combination with a stout is of course also a brownie. But I also really like this combination, a piece of blue cheese with the stout. You have this wonderful interaction of the saltiness and of the cheese and the bitters. The bitters become a bit more subtle. It's not a hop bitter here, but it's a bit more of the roasted bitter. So you also have these chocolate flavors that go really well with cheese. So again, if you're ever going to buy a piece of blue cheese, perhaps it's good to buy a stout as well. Yeah, that was it actually. I hope it worked out by using this Zoom session to teach you a little bit about the bitters in here. Cheers.
And someone who knows a lot about bitterness as a metaphor is our next speaker. Please give a warm applause to artist, photographer, and scholar Sarojini Lewis.
Okay, I will start now. So thank you very much for asking me to give this talk tonight, and I'm very pleased to be here. Let's look at the first slide. So I'm going to take you on a journey of a 5-year period, which has all kinds of images that I took myself or archival material, and it's been part of my research as a PhD scholar in New Delhi at the Jawaharlal Nehru University, but also as an artist working for a while on diverse subjects. So yeah, let me start the journey with telling you a little bit about the subject that I started to work on in 2015. In 2015, I was invited for a residency in Dresden. And yeah, this is an image on the screen. You can see the landscape also of the Sächsische Schweiz, which is South Germany. I'm holding the Kreila there. But at that time, I was starting this research of migration of India to Suriname. And this kind of was also the reason why I was invited there, to look at some missionary archive. And these missionaries looked at the Hindustani community of Suriname, and they observed all kinds of daily things. So while going there, I had this in my mind. So these kind of traces of migration can be also found in the villages in India, which are mostly the Bhojpuri community. You can say that this migration also brought back habits and things from India to Suriname, and later on, of course, as you all know, I think, to the Netherlands. So I'm going to discuss some different examples of the art practice, as well as the some of the research elements. So anyway, here you see the Kreila in between my hands. And I had found this in a shop in Dresden whilst I was thinking of these missionary archives. So I was quite surprised to see this vegetable there, because it was in a way very unexpected. I didn't think I would find this vegetable in the shop. And I felt a connection connection started to grow between this meeting of this vegetable and the idea that I had a similar migration route as this vegetable. And so I bought this vegetable and brought it on a journey to this Sächsische Schweiz, where I was with a German artist who asked me to cook Indian food. So at that time frame, I was quite surprised, because of course I see myself as a Dutch person, but of course people also expect me to cook Indian food. So I brought this quite unusual vegetable with me to cook this for the guests. And here you see one of the objects that was there in the museum, part of the ethnological collection. So you, this is kind of a music instrument, a drum, and a hookah, a pipe to smoke. And I pasted it on the Indian newspaper. So from the journey from Germany to India, I sort of took these pictures of the collection, and sort of later also collected a newspaper. So it's a bit crisscross, but that's quite typical of my work, so don't mind, please. And now I want to also let you know a little bit about my personal route to this migration. So in the top you can see Sukai Gayadin. If you can see it, it's like 1877 till 1928. And he was the one who took the boat from Calcutta to Paramaribo. And he married in Paramaribo to Munia Danu, who also came by boat from Calcutta to Paramaribo. And then they had all these children and so on and so on. And you can see all the names. And then in the bottom, you can see my name in 1984. So little bits to also see my own connection to this migration story. And now we are back in Germany, because you can see the curator holding the veil of the object. The object was kind of representable for the Surinamese migration. But I had a few questions, because I thought, like, this object doesn't look like it's from Suriname. So how come it's representable for these for the Suriname community? And I also put it on my own head, as you can see on the image below. And I thought, no, I most certainly think this is not from Suriname. And I started to research the object, and it appeared so that it came from Egypt. So this was quite interesting, because it's kind of like an imaginary migration of the object itself. So you can imagine that for one moment it stands representable for a community, and the next moment, all of a sudden, it appears to be from Egypt. So it's kind of this mind mapping, or this mind migration that's imaginary whilst researching the object. So it's also kind of, I thought this was an interesting mistake, an interesting occasion of displacement also. And here, a few other objects, and then I printed them with cyanotype on a roof in India. So there's a glass plate and some chemicals involved. And yeah. Also a very normal basket, but it's also representable for the community. So I was quite interested in also this physical connection of holding the objects that you're, so to say, connected with. But it also appears like a very normal basket. So it's this kind of interesting layers that I wanted to play with and look at. Then here you can see another object. It's an object, birds, and this is quite something that you see quite often in India, in the households. And I have to say that I didn't see it as much in Suriname. Like, it's really this like clay and baked kind of, ornaments. It's meant to be hung nearby doorways. And I haven't seen that so often in Suriname. So there are like different routes. So of course I'm drifting away from the Kraila a bit, but then you can see the context of how I started to work with this vegetable whilst also looking at these ethnographic objects and looking at the head of a missionary here. And then of course you have the archival images that were taken in these are from Tropen Museum and the Leiden Archive in 1930 and 1940. And you can see the women, the Hindustani women in the market selling their vegetable. And this is very, for me, it was very important to see this, the context, and also to later on write about these images. And imagine that they were also selling Kraila, which of course must have traveled as a seed on the boat, so to speak, to this country where it was grown and also changed in shape. This is an image of Julius Müller, one of the first photographers in Suriname. And you can see, of course, the Dutch painted landscape in the back, and then the lady in the front, and the little, I can use this thing to point. Here you see the plant that is part of Suriname, the imagined plant that is part of maybe a more Dutch landscape leading up to the houses. It's not the typical house you see in Suriname. And then you have the lady with the sari. So it's kind of these different elements that are integrated into one picture that are quite interesting, like somehow surrealistic in my opinion. In Dresden, I learned to take distance. distance from what I've done before. Work with myself as a material. Don't you want to create? Empty bottles on the street, broken glass anywhere, no places to sleep after the 30th. So that's why I go home. If only you wrote. A woman with bags collecting garbage barefoot. It is because she's poor. We knocked and rang the bell of a second apartment. Someone walking by in pyjamas, shambles around, bursting buildings, sparkling champagne. No, it's a mix with white wine. If only you wrote me, and the photograph I saw could be forgotten. I think by now you may have a taste also of this Karaila, which is also, I'm very thankful for Caro to prepare the Karaila today, so I'm really very happy that she went to the Togo to get the Karaila and to also prepare it for us. So later on, hopefully, I will also taste it. Yeah. And here I wanted to explain you a little bit about my meeting in Dresden with Rabia, who's from Pakistan, and that we together went to the Togo there in Dresden because we kind of missed Asian food, and you know, she really was missing home. So in this way, I ended up being in the Togo there and finding this, maybe they don't call it Togo in Germany, I don't know, but that is how I came to know that this Karaila, or Sopropo, the same name, is found there. And here we kind of restaged our meeting. So I'm wearing her kurta, and I asked a passerby to take this picture. And then later on, someone asked me like, oh, is this a refugee camp? Because in Germany, in 2015, they were really active with the refugees. So I thought it was quite interesting, you know, if you exhibit these images that people start imagining it's a refugee camp, because you see a fence and you see, of course, people in foreign clothes or something. But this was actually the place where German language students were placed. And they were mostly coming from like Asia, like Sri Lanka, Pakistan. And there was me coming from Netherlands, but because the Brigitte was active in this time frame, they thought it would be better to put me safe with the language students, because otherwise Brigitte was a neo-Nazi movement and they would attack so-called foreigners. So they were a bit afraid to put me nearby this square. So this was also interesting, because then you know that somehow you are mingling with people who have a very different sort of background as well than yours, but there is a familiarity in it as well. So I wasn't unhappy, but I was also thinking how interesting that other people then think it's a refugee camp. So these are all, you know, things that play a role with this Karaila. And Rabia, she learned me this expression, Karaila Jesa Mu Kyom Banaya He. Why do you look so pissed off? Posting one letter to India. The German post is on strike. The woman observed me and said, but maybe you're lucky. Having a face like Karaila. Copying the form 6 times. Forgetting to paste 1 extra photograph. But I live in room 13. Sign of being bitter, Skyping the number over again, speaking to someone overseas. The line cracked. Madam, I cannot hear you. Excuse me. I'm sure it's a good room, and I'm sure it's a good number. Yeah, here we arrive at a later work. You can see the expression I just pronounced, probably not perfect, but it's written, oops, let me go back. It's written over here. So these are all phrases of the poem I just read you. And I thought it was quite interesting, you know, because why do you have a face like a gorilla? It's also, why do you have a bitter expression? Why are you, you know, so upset or angry or pissed off? So I was really interested that this kind of bitterness of the vegetable also was related to an emotion. And then when I think, of course, of the colonial history of Suriname, of course there are bitter memories as well. So I wanted to relate to the colonial history in this way, with taste and with memories that are not outspoken and mostly silenced. And especially in this generation, people don't really know anymore what kind of you know, exact memories their ancestors had, because most of their grandparents already passed, and these are the people, the third generation, who would know these things. So it's kind of a silence there, and you don't know what exactly happened. Nobody can tell you, nobody experienced it, because they all passed. So I think this bitterness for me was a way to relate to this history of, you know, which was of course quite extreme, because from one day they were taken from a village, and the other day you're working on a plantation in Suriname. And then it's of course a so-called multicultural society, so a strictly divided labor situation where everybody with a different race had to do special task. So this is kind of something that they have experienced. And then I wanted to relate to this history in this way by, you know, putting the karaila on my face, like you see here. And this one you call actually karaili. So it's a smaller version. And I think like the texture and making this more emotional connection for me was a way how I wanted to relate to this history, colonial history, but also to a personal history and an emotionally connected history. And I think then this is where I can sort of finish this talk and end the presentation. And these are some details of the work. And it's a work that's been printed right now, and you can see it in September in Wereldmuseum Rotterdam, if you're interested. And there is also a whole film that is especially, so everything I made there is especially based on this vegetable gorilla, but is also the leader in connecting different narratives of people and their lives. So I kind of made it a metaphor. And yeah, thank you very much for listening. And that is that's it for now. Oh yeah, the film. Oh, I'm so sorry. I completely forgot. Almost forgot to tell you that there is a little bit of a preview of the film. Yeah, I'm very sorry. Must need another coffee, another bitter item. So please have a look at this film. And so the whole film is to be able, you can see that in September in Rotterdam, in Wereldmuseum.
Sarojini, I think it's time to conclude your lecture. First of all, please give her a very warm applause. And maybe there are some questions from the audience. I also have a question. First of all, I'm really fascinated by the fact how this sopropo, Karaila, became an embodied metaphor. So what is it like for you to eat Karaila? What happens? What kind of emotions do you feel?
I think that, when I found the vegetable in Germany, it felt like more like this idea of sense of belonging and home somehow, gave me that connection by the taste, because sometimes you are in an environment where you are feeling a little maybe not completely connected to the city and its people. And then I think a taste like that really remembers you of home, you know, where your aunt is cooking in the kitchen and she's preparing something during your childhood. So kind of those memories are really important and connected to that taste. And it's only when you are away from home when you experience that kind of memory through taste, actually.
So to you, bitter is positive, although there's a bitter aftertaste of what it stands for. It's migratory root.
This is the way I associate it with the taste, because I think that there are also many struggles, perhaps identity struggles, or not really understanding where you come from and why it went like that and what the people had to endure. So I think this is also part of the taste. Something traveled and something changed. And I think that's maybe part of such a long route of exploration, but also maybe, they probably also had, not everything is positive for the ancestors, I think, who worked so hard on the plantations. So that is something I have in mind also with this taste, that it's something to overcome, perhaps, but an association you have with bitterness. Yeah.
Thank you. I think that's truly beautiful. Are there any questions in the room for Sarojini? So, there's a question over there. I'll give you my microphone.
Really, really nice talk. Thank you.
In the movie, I can see that you associate the Karaila also with water a lot, like the rain and the water here on the floor. Does that have a meaning?
At this point of time, the house was flooded of my aunt, and it literally also came into her bathroom. So it was not a very nice situation. And you know, every time her house floods and every time she has to sleep in the water. So I was feeling quite sad somehow, very powerless that I couldn't, you know, improve her situation. And then I also felt that the situation and the body that is quite isolated in this sense because of our current corona crisis, it was more a response to the body being in isolation and this situation of flood that I wanted to connect this Karaila with, because this also feels more like a liberation, you know, with the vegetable together. But of course, it's not growing in this homely, you know, environment. So it would be much more in nature where you would see it grow. But of course, the rain, the heavy rains are part of the fertility of the ground in Suriname, because it's extremely fertile ground there. And you wouldn't find that in India, for example. And I think that's the reason why they're probably much bigger there. That's one of the reasons. But the rain is, of course, very presentable for this fertility also, I think.
Thank you. Yeah, it's something I also noticed when I went to the Toko, because you asked me to go there. There are small ones and really big ones. And
yeah,
the big
that's
ones
right.
are from Suriname.
The big ones, they are, you cannot find them in India. At least I haven't seen them at all. So I think that the big ones are really only uniquely from Suriname. And the smaller ones that are like this size or a little bit longer, they are from India. And they are also much thinner, so a little bit small and thinner. And the bigger ones are from Suriname. And they say that, you mentioned that they say that Sopropo is from Suriname and Kerala from India, but actually the name is used, both names are used, but Sopropo more because it's a Suriname word. And I think Kerala, they don't use Sopropo in India at all. They wouldn't know what you would like to have if you say that. So it's basically also to do with the regions, I think. Yeah.
Sarojini, Lewis, thank you so much. Please give her another applause.
Yeah, thank you also.
And again, if you want to see her entire artwork, go to the almost reopened Wereldmuseum in Rotterdam. And now we're on for a break, so see you again in 15 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome after the break for our second part of The Bitter Essence. How did you like that Sopropo, Kerala? Yeah? Will you buy it yourself, prepare it at home? This was with masala spices, this particular version. Of course, we're in a really peculiar time. Times where we Zoom, everything is digital. That's why it's extra hard to do an odorama on a distance, over a distance, because the sense of smell, the sense of taste cannot be digitized. And that's why I wanted to share something else with you. I actually know a synesthete. A synesthete is someone who perceives through one sense, but experiences it through another sense, like hearing colors. Is any one of you a synesthete? You're a synesthete. Okay. Nice. Yeah. Anyone else? Letters and colors? Another one. I know a synesthete who tastes words. So the first time I talked to him, he suddenly ran off. I said something very distasteful. It was very, I don't know, maybe bitter. It was very foul to him. So I emailed him and I asked, okay, the word bitter, what does it taste like? And he told me, okay, bitter. Bitter is a very sharp taste. It's like the peel of a lemon, only the word bitter, right? So not the taste bitter. And there are a few words that are particularly bitter. One of them is Philip. Is anyone called Philip? No Phillips. And the other word was fit. So the reason I'm telling this is because synesthesia is a really interesting means, a really interesting tool in these times, these digital times, to address those non-digitizable senses. Do you understand what I mean? Could be a really interesting tool. But now we're on for our next speaker, Sabine Pausma, founder of Cacao Lab, also working for the Rijksmuseum. Please give her a warm applause, Sabine Pausma.
So, hello everybody. The first one. Okay, 16 years ago, I moved to Zaandam. And as you can see, it's not the most beautiful place on earth. But Yeah, most of all, it smelled like cocoa all day long. And not just one day, but 365 days of the year. So maybe, I think maybe the people who sit here are smelling it a little bit, but over here there's a pan with a warm pan, which roasts the beans. So that's the smell you can smell in Zaandam. And so after a while, I was asking myself, what is going on here? What do I exactly smell? And after a few months, I discovered I moved to one of the biggest, or actually the biggest, cocoa industry of the world, the largest cocoa region of the world. There are a lot of factories and machine factories, most of all, a lot of cocoa processing industry. So actually, what is cocoa, I ask myself, and what are they doing? And what do I exactly smell? So cocoa is a pod. This is the cocoa fruit. It grows at the trunk of the tree. And this is a real one, a dried one. But they can be, the fresh ones can be different colors, from green to yellow to purple. And they grow a tropical area around the world, tropical circle around the world, also in Suriname, also with a nice bitter fruits over there. And if you open the fruit, there are seeds inside, 30 to 50 seeds. And if you take the seed out of the pot and you will taste it directly, then around the seed there's a white pulp. And this pulp is very nice, mango, lemon, it's very nice and sweet. But the inside, the cocoa bean, the seed itself, is really astringent and really, really bitter. I see someone nodding there, maybe you already ate it once, but it's really astringent, really bitter. So what on earth do people do to make chocolate from this bean? So it's the most popular candy sweet on earth. So there must be something, there must be a lot of things happening before this is a nice piece of chocolate. So the first thing they do to influence the taste of this seed is to put it on a big heap and cover it up with banana leaves. So fermentation. So they just let it roll. The color is changing from grayish, deep purple to brown. So the inside of the bean is now totally changed, and it gives a richer flavor to the bean, but also it will be brown. So after the fermentation, it's a very wet process. The bean is still very wet. The beans have to be dried. And in your, hoe zeg je dat, een schoteltje? In your cup, dish, there's two beans. One is a little lighter, one is a little darker. So the lightest bean is the dried and fermented bean. So if you crack the bean a little bit with your teeth, then you will find out there is a skin around it. The skin you don't eat, and the inside of the bean, so the skin is named husk, and the inside of the bean is the cocoa nib. And if you eat that, maybe you can experience it's astringent and bitter. So when the bean is, so after fermentation, the bean has to be dried, and then also the outside of the bean is getting browner by oxidation. So how do you like the bean? It's nice? Yeah? Oh. Yeah, I can, eh? So there are bitter fanatics here, of course. So, Yeah, so now you have only one bean, but if you should eat another fermented and raw bean, it can be totally different. Yeah, so in a big heap, different beans, different temperatures, can be really different. Okay, so after drying, the bean is ready for transport. The biggest cocoa harbor is in Amsterdam, and then the most of the beans are entering Zaandam for processing. So the first thing the factories are doing is they are going to roast the bean. And roasting is also a very important step, because the roasting influences the astringency and the bitterness very, very much. So the next bean is the darker one. You can crack it a little bit, and then you will notice it's more easy to crack it. So just get rid of the husk. So you blow it away or you peel it off, and then you will eat the next bean. And maybe you taste the difference. Sometimes it's more nutty or more roasted. I see very wrinkles in your forehead. You don't like it? No? The first one is okay? And this one is more? More what? Bitter? Burnt, yeah. Sometimes when you roast it too much, it's over-roasted. And that's also a sign for bad chocolate, for example. Yeah, so every step you do with the bean is influencing the piece of chocolate later. So, and of course, I over-roasted it a little bit to have a bit of better contrast. So it's a little bit tricky, of course. Okay, so after roasting, the beans are cracked. You take a bit of the husk, and then they are grinded. So when you grind the cocoa bean, there's 50% of fat in the bean. So when you grind it warm, it will be a nice, warm, and fluid cocoa mass. And what do we do with the cocoa mass? So let's go back a little bit, 1500 years before Christ. The Maya culture used the cocoa mass to make a drink. And they mixed the drink, the very bitter and astringent cocoa mass, they mixed it with honey to compensate the bitter. So that's recognizable. It's very similar to beer, eh? So that's really funny. Okay, so they mixed it with honey. And also with cinnamon and vanilla, and also with chili pepper. So we noticed by the beer that the chili pepper is doing something with the bitterness, but also the honey and vanilla and all the spices. And then you will see over here, you will see this nice Maya man, and he's putting the cocoa drink high up in the air to pull it all up down the floor, so to make a frothy drink. The froth, the foam on the drink was really important for the sensation for tasting the bitterness and the whole drink. So foam in a drink is very important for experiencing it. So let's go big steps ahead. 16th century, Hernán Cortés introduced the cocoa bean in Spain, and then was also the start that they mixed the cocoa mass with sugar, of course, with sugar cane sugar instead of honey, and also to make it more softer, they used milk and cream. So that makes it more creamy and soft and less bitter. So in the 17th century, it was familiar in the rest of Europe, and most very important of their drink, it was an elite drink. It was just for the higher class. It was very expensive, very exotic, especially also in the 17th century, the trading with spices, and it was good for your health. It gave you energy because, of course, of this 50% of fat in the bean. So it was a very fat and energetic drink. And so it was used as a medicine, but also it was very good because you will be sexually excited by this drink. So that's nice about this piece of art. She put her dress over here. So she's waiting. This is a typical chocolate can with a sideward handle. And what do you think this is? This is a little letter. So I don't know what's in it, but it's really exciting. So when we count all the years, it's more than 3,500 years of drinking the chocolates. So all the way, this chocolate was consumed fluid until there was a Dutch guy who made a big change. And his name, the name of this handsome man, is Johannes Koenraad, eigenlijk Koenhout Johannes van Houten. He invented how to separate the fat from the cocoa because he didn't like the fat in the drink. And he invented a very cheap way how to separate it. He put the warm and fluid cocoa mass in the press. So the solid particles will stay in the press and the fluid particles are dripping out. So that is really nice because now we don't have only one ingredient, the cocoa mass, with 50% of fat. Now we have three ingredients. We have cocoa mass, we have the pressed cocoa mass, so that's the cocoa powder, and we have cocoa butter. So that's three cocoa particles, of actually two cocoa particles, cocoa particle powder and fat. So we can make now, we can make a chocolate drink with almost no fat, but most of all, it's possible to make a chocolate bar. That's very good. An edible chocolate. And the first chocolate, edible chocolate bar was, of course, with cocoa mass and sugar and a little bit of extra butter to make it more fluid. And guess what? It was not in Holland, but it was made in England. Mr. Fry made the first edible chocolate bar. And that was in 1847, the dark chocolate. And of course, they missed the nice and creamy milk. And it took a little while, but finally, Henry Nestle invented to conserve milk, and he dried it and made a powder. So that was the invention of the milky powder. And his neighbor, Daniel Peter, was a chocolatier, and he said, okay, that's really nice because we missed the creamy side of the chocolate. So let's try to mix the powder with bitter chocolate. So he developed the first milky chocolate. And that was not in Holland, it was in Switzerland. So it was really convenient. You don't have to drink your chocolate on the spot, but you can just wrap it in paper and take it with you. So finally, milk has always been, in Europe, milk has always been a very important ingredient to fight the bitterness, even when you're eating it. Now later, much more later, the white chocolate was invented, but that's not interesting for tonight, because all the bitterness is actually totally gone and tasteless. So now you will see, bitterness is very important to make something really nice. I told you it's a lot of similarities with beer. So this is really look like the grains, yeah. So the different colors. Mr. van Houten did not only invent how to separate the fat from the cocoa, he also invented how to balance the acids in cocoa. So what he did was he put an alkali to it. That's the opposite of acid. And because it's a Dutch invention, they call it Dutching. So the left one is the natural color, And that's not Dutch color. This one is Dutch color, a Dutch cocoa powder. And the black one is double Dutched. So when you double Dutch a cocoa powder, then all the acids are totally gone. And so you will experience a total different cocoa powder. And so the normal cocoa powder is acid. So that gives you a nice flavor and a beautiful balance together with bitterness. And in the black one, it's totally different. So on your plate, you have two cups, one yellowish and one black. So when you open it, you can smell the powder. And oh yeah, for the people at home, yeah, you can take out the paper maybe. And then smell the, yeah, maybe you put it on a table or on a plate. And then smell the black powder and smell the yellowish powder. So what do you think? So maybe if you dare, you can also wet your finger a little bit and then put your finger in it. So first you put it in the yellowish, and then you put it on the in the black one. And if you have some black powder in your mouth, maybe you stick your tongue out and look what's happening on your tongue. Yeah, you have to stick your tongue out to each other, eh? Then you can see what's happening on your tongue. Now you have to make it a little bit more, I think. You have to make a lot of powder on your tongue. So also, when you stick your tongue out, you will notice your tongue is totally black with a double-dutched cocoa powder. So actually, who likes... What do you think of the powders? Okay, so the smell is better in the light one. So that's the smell is more soft and more chocolatey. And the taste is better in the black one, she says. Yes, yeah, the powder is also a very modern way to consume the new chocolate way of chocolate. You can also
smell
sniff it.
Smell is coming into your nostrils. The smell is coming into the nostrils.
Yeah, it's a very fine grinded powder. It's fine grinded until it's 25 mu. And when it's so fine grinded, that's the particle particle which you don't have the sensation of a sandy structure. So it's so fine grinded that if you make a piece of chocolate with it, with this powder, then you have the melting sensation. Okay, so this black powder is not tasting very well, I think. It's kind of soapy smell. And if you stick your tongue out, you will have a very black tongue. And that's why they use this powder for. Most of the black powder is going to the Oreo cookies. So the Oreo cookies doesn't even taste like chocolate. They are just colored with chocolate. But the nice thing is, you can see, they advise you to dip it in the milk. Guess what? Where that is coming from. So it's referring to the chocolate drink again. So also the black color is going back into the chocolates. And that is a little bit, yeah, that's not very good, eh? If you have to color your chocolate. So there is a piece, black piece of chocolate on your plate. That's the 90% lint. And if you take a little piece of that, don't put the whole stuff in your mouth, it's very big. Yeah, of course you can do it, but it's not my advice to take. It's my advice is to take a little piece. So, oh yeah, so for the people at home, you can eat the round pieces of chocolate, this one, the round pieces of chocolate, and that is the bulk chocolate. That's a 70% bulk chocolate. So just when you eat the chocolate, then don't chew on it. Just let it melt in your mouth, and then you get the most flavors, if there's any flavor in this chocolate. So what do you think of this chocolate?
It's really ashy.
Very ashy. Now, that's true. You know, 90% of chocolate is, that means it's only 10% of sugar. So that's, yeah, that's rather bitter. But this chocolate is not really bitter. And that means it's a lot of cocoa butter, maybe 70%, it's not on the package, but maybe 70% of cocoa butter, maybe 10% of this black double Dutch cocoa powder, and maybe 80% of maybe the rest, 20% of or 10% of cocoa mass. So in this chocolate, you can taste that's not very chocolatey. You don't have any bouquet of acids or bitterness, yeah, a little bitter maybe, or but it's a very flat and dull bitter taste. So of course we don't finish with this taste. I want to finish with a nice and beautiful bouquet of bitterness, and everything what a chocolate needs is to go back to original taste of the cocoa bean. So the other piece of chocolate, what's on your plate, is from the Dutch chocolate maker Smashokke. And it's a 70% cocoa. That means it's about 30% of sugar, and it's only biologic cane sugar. It's a single bean, that means it's not a blend of different cocoa beans, but only a single bean of Tanzania. So you have a specific taste of that area. And the roast, you see how important this is. First 10%, 10 degrees, 120, 60, 100. So that means they are balancing the acids and the astringency and the bitterness by roasting it in a specific way. And you see, it's a whole profile of taste. So if you put this piece of chocolate in your mouth, you just let it melt, and you will notice you have a whole bouquet of different flavors. And the funny thing is, you also notice the fruity, the red fruits. In beers, you will notice, or in hop, you will also notice the different tastes of fruit or nuts. And that's exactly the same with cocoa. So what do you think of this chocolate? It's different, huh? Yeah. So with one little piece of chocolate, you have about 15 minutes pleasure in your mouth. And also you can pair it with a nice glass of beer. So that's even. Okay. So let's embrace the bitterness in chocolate. And if you eat chocolate, take your time. So, because a good piece of chocolate is a slow food. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Sabine. It was wonderful. Beautiful. Odyssey on the tongue. We're on to our last speaker. If you have any questions for Sabine, please ask them afterwards. We're running a bit out of time. So our last, but not least, of course, speaker, Keeswa Beke, is a biologist, a handicraft teacher. And, well, he'll tell you all about a project he did especially for this evening. Okay, give him a warm applause. Keeswa Beke.
Well, thank you. Good evening. My name is Kees Waabeke, and I'm a school garden teacher in Amsterdam, one of the beautiful school gardens in Amsterdam. And today I'm going to tell you about my work, about a very special project we have this year. And I did a little test about bitter plants, and we're going to do it as well with all the people here. This year, it's our 100 years anniversary, and I'm going to tell you why we don't grow any bitter plants in the school gardens. And we're going to see if it's true, if it's a good idea not to grow them. This picture we can see a lot. The green letters are the gardens. We have 13 gardens in Amsterdam. I work on this one, the most beautiful one in Amsterdam. Also live there. And there are 13 gardens. It started in 1920. And actually, there should be 14 gardens, because there, in 1920, there was a lady who wanted to stimulate the school gardens, and her big dream was 14 school gardens in Amsterdam, but we only have 13. This is a class in 1928, one of the first, and if you take a close look at the children, what do we see? A lot of them. I think 30 children is a lot, but these were mostly 40 children, and they look very serious, especially this one, this one, this one. This one you can't see, but more happy than the rest. But they look innocent. But I don't think they are. I should be a bit afraid from a class like this, maybe. Look at this little guy. And they all look very neat. The best clothes, I think that was especially for the picture. And nowadays we tell them, put on your old clothes that make it dirty because you work in the soil. But they didn't. And that must be for the picture. This is 1931, a school garden of a school garden teacher wearing nice suit. You can see the children, wooden shoes, and of course clothes from 1931. This picture is more spontaneous, I think, more like the kids were, and they're going to garden. 1952. Tomatoes. Nowadays we don't grow them, the tomatoes, because they all get sick. When you grow them, there's a disease in the ground, and that makes the plant sick, tomatoes. But in 1952 it was all right, I think, and they look good, ready to harvest. 1970, a little girl, very happy with her carrots. She harvests them. She put the seeds in the ground, she took care of them, and she took them out of the ground. She takes them home, and she eats them. That's what we still do today. Look, 2019. Apart from the clothes, there are little differences. Yes, she's as happy as the other girl. And actually what we do 100 years, and nothing changed very much. Very simple, piece of ground. Children, you grow vegetables, you grow herbs, you grow flowers, you take care of them, you harvest them, you take them home. Very simple concept. But of course there's more. Nowadays it's more focused on nature education. This is like catching animals. We also catch soil animals that live in the ground. We teach them it's all important, that nature is more than just something outside, but very important for you. And that's more what we are focused on today. And of course, preparing healthy food. Our big goal is to grow foods and to let children eat it as well. Children and vegetables are a difficult combination, we all know that. But if they grow them themselves, maybe they can like it, maybe they eat it. That's what we're trying. And this is our very, the best lesson we have, I think, the soup lesson. What we do, in 1.5 hours, children go to their garden, they harvest something. Every kid harvests one particular vegetable. They cut it, in pieces, they wash it, they cook it, and they eat it, all in 1.5 hours. And yeah, a class of children is about 25-30 children. The other class coming in 1.5 hours, you have to be very fast. It's all about organization. And of course, children enjoying their soup. 2020, 100 years. And as part of the celebration, I might teach a group of children in the garden of the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam. And 3 years ago, I had this idea. I thought, well, it's very special what Amsterdam does for the children, because they pay everything. And what can we do better than in the center of the garden of the Rijksmuseum, center of the world, maybe, we make a garden and we ask a class to come and, well, do our school garden project. So, yeah, somebody wrote a letter for me. I didn't do it myself. And the Rijksmuseum said, yes, of course, why not? Go ahead. And so we did. This is the class of children. Maybe you know the place. Very beautiful. Statues all around. Very valuable. Cameras watching the children. Garden. In the middle is a chessboard. Maybe you've seen it sometimes. And yeah, we are doing what we are doing in every garden. Children think it's very normal. The children don't think it's very special. They just go to the garden, in the Rijksmuseum, do their work and go home again. But for me, it's very special. This is the class. Yeah, look, this is the museum. It's really, really there. And they're all very happy. Children are always very happy in the school garden, but this place, they are even more happy. First harvest, onions this time. Yeah, what can we see more? These are potatoes, herbs. This little plastic bowl is a special story because last year I tried to grow all kind of vegetables in that garden and it went all right. There were sometimes some snails, not a big problem. But this year it's a very big problem. That's why we invented this. To prevent the snails from eating the vegetables. But there are a lot of snails, so let's hope tomorrow I'm going to have a look there. After 2 weeks, if there's anything left, but we'll see. This is our cultivation schedule. What can we see? Herbs. We can see flowers. We can see vegetables, a lot of vegetables. And we don't see very much bitter plants. The only one that's a little bit bitter is the boerenkool, kale. And maybe the radish, but the rest are all very friendly to kids. And why do we do it? Because we think bitter plants and children is not a good combination. Because we hope children eat vegetables, and if they're bitter, they won't eat them at all. So that's why we don't grow bitter plants. But is it true? So I invented a little test. I had 4 little cups. This one is Brussels sprout. No, chicory. Brussels sprout, dandelion, and lettuce. And they are bitter, a little bit bitter, bitterer. Dandelion is very bitter. And the lettuce is sweet compared to the other ones. The children could taste it, and they can rate it as well. So, bakje 1. Give it 1 point, disgusting, 10 points, very nice. And yeah, these are my hypothesis, difficult word. Dutch children do not like bitter flavors. Dutch children with a Surinamese background are more used to the bitter flavors, sopropo. And they will rate the bitter taste higher. So we tried tasting. He's very curious what will happen. Rating? Maybe not. And then the results. I had two schools. This is Klaverblad, school with mostly children with a African background, Suriname background, and the Neptunus school with mostly European background children. What do we see? Well, chicory, Klaverblad likes it a bit more, but all the other ones, the Neptunus school likes them, rates them higher, and the lettuce is rated higher by Klaverblad. So my expectations were not quite true. The Neptunus school likes the bitter taste a bit more, but they all tend to lettuce. Well, the results. Lettuce was rated highest. Yeah, I expected that. But this is strange. Not quite what I expected. Maybe they didn't eat enough sopropo at home, I don't know. And the chicory is an exception to this. And or they liked it, they gave it 10 points, or they gave it 1 point. So either they liked it or they hated it. Conclusion, yeah, they don't like bitter tasting plants. And that must be the reason why they have not been included in our cultivation schedule for the past 100 years. So I think we were right not to do it. What may be interesting is that you do the same test. We have bakjes with four different vegetables, the same one as the children had. We can do it later as well, though.
Yeah.
And but it's a bit different. You have to taste them, you have to remember it. And number one was the, well, you can see it at this bicycle. If you tasted it and you have remembered it, you can walk here and rate the different vegetables. And then we can see what the difference is between children and grown-ups. If it's true that grown-ups like bitter taste more than children. There's a little warning. And that's the dandelion, part blue. This one, is very, very bitter. If you have a little bit, it will be enough, I think. And when we did the test with the children, it was early spring, and then they're not so bitter as in summer, as today. So go ahead, taste, and you can rate them at the bicycle. Could somebody give a reaction? What's the taste like? I'm especially interested in the dandelion. What you think about that?
Chicory is super nice.
Chicory is super nice. Not so bitter.
No, super fresh.
Yeah.
It's super nice. I missed the bitters of the chicory, but it's super crispy, sweet. Yeah.
Yeah. And the Brussels sprout, somebody has tasted the Brussels sprout, has a reaction? No?
The witlof is
sweet.
Chicory with love.
We have some reactions here in the back that says it's very sweet.
Yeah.
There is quite some people that say that chicory is very sweet. Do people agree with that?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. A lot of bitterness has been selected out of it. I don't know how to say it, but it's not as bitter as it used to be, the bitter vegetables we know. But the dandelion is coming straight from my garden, the wild plant. Must be very bitter. It is, yeah? Mm-hmm. If you tasted it, you can rate it at the bicycle. There's a little present as well. Because it's our 100 years anniversary, you can take a card, send it to somebody and tell them, put it in the ground and they will grow plants out of it because there are seeds inside. This big banner here, you can have a look, all old pictures. If you want to know exactly what's on it, you can have a look at this one. Maybe you're interested. There will be a film about our about the 100th anniversary from October in the cinema. And a book you can buy at the Rijksmuseum shop. So if you're interested, you can have a look. And please rate the vegetables with a stripe.
And when you rated it, we will post, then Kees will do the math, and we'll post the results on social media. So you'll know how you scored in relation to the children.
Okay, well, thank you very much. That's okay.
So thank you everyone for being here. I want to thank the speakers, Bas Visser, Sarojini Lewis, Kees Wabeke, Sabine Pausma, but also all the people who helped produce this, and most of all, Julia Morris. She did a lot of work. She made all those packages, but she wasn't alone. I'm so bad with names, so I wrote them down. We also had help from two aroma jockeys. Agne, where are she? Ah, there they are. And Anna. Monica, who did audio. Abby did photography. And then Yessin. And Ines, live stream, yeah. It's the bitter end, but we know bitter is very positive now. It's very healthy. It's a culturally acquired taste. And if children started with it sooner, maybe they would like it. So I don't know, maybe the conclusion is the other way around. Maybe children would have liked it if you would have grown bitter vegetables. There is a next odorama planned, the 27th of August, curated by Frank Bloem, Playful Smells. You probably all remember your fragrant toys from your childhood. Who had a fragrant toy? No one. Yeah. And you probably remember that smell. It's so nostalgic. So Frank will host this event, 27th of August. I hope you'll all be there and have a bitter evening. Oh, in the meantime, as someone in the audience suggested, you can also do Aroma Lab every Thursday with Frank and Niklaus, where you can blend your own perfumes. That's so cool. This is about the only place where you can do this. So check that out. Hope to see you soon.
open in the restaurant. It's not a drink.
Thank you.